Books are thin, books are fat, books are thick, books are flat. Some books are classic, others are dumb. There's one on every subject under the sun. William Shakespeare, Harry Potter, written by Mrs. Rowling's daughter. Philip Roth, Dr. Seuss, E.B. White, and Marcel Proust. Now science courses, books on horses, B-books, tree books, all for you. Mysteries and histories, who done it, how to do it, why they do it, what they do. Oh, Holden, Caulfield, Nancy Drew, Long John Silver, and Tarzan too. I love Captain Underpants and the Hunchback of Notre Dame from France. Astrology, astronomy, books on World Wars 1 and 2, they're a politics and parlor tricks. Who done it, how to do it, why they do it, what they do. Shel Silverstein and Oscar Wilde, Henry James and Julia Child, Maurice Sendak, Caleb Carr, and the rest, well, they know who they are. Some books have pictures, others don't. Some you'll get and others you won't. Some books are boring, but most are fun. There's one on every subject, including the sun. Who done it, how to do it, why they do it, what they do. Ooh!
This is a 3D printer, and it's printing in a corn-based plastic called PLA. It's printing a model. The model is brought into the printer using an SD card. The file format is STL, which is a universal file format that's used with every single printer. And it's converted into something called G-code so that it can be printed layer by layer. So that's what you're seeing now. And we're using an app called Morphe, which is a 3D modeling app for iPad and iPad mini, where you can design objects that can be printed in any printer, and you can design them using your fingers.
What are you printing right now? Just a shape?
No, we're printing a tiny robot. You can zoom in and try to see it.
I did. I zoomed right in on it.
Also, just so that you know, you can print in many, many different types of materials. So that's hard plastic, but for example, you can print in something that's even more. Even that, if you touch that ball, can you give me that ball? Please? Thank you. So this ball is printed in a different kind of plastic that's flexible. So you can print, you know, harder material or flexible material. And in
metal.
Different colors. So there are metal printers. This does not print in metal, but there are printers that exist that print in metal, in chocolate. People are printing in skin, in, you know, their bio printers. All different materials. So
prostheses?
Prostheses can be made with this material. They're making actually prostheses for children using this material because it's softer and it's more flexible. But even with the hard material, they're using it as well. So it's possible. It's all possible.
And is this something that is so extensive that it will only be available to large corporations,
so
government?
No. I mean, the prices are coming down. They're not super inexpensive. I think the cheapest one I've seen so far is $400 or $500. But this one is a more expensive model. This is about $2,600. But they're cheaper models. They're cheaper printers. They're printers you could put together in a kit, and it'll be maybe, you know, $400 or $500. It's possible.
And what would someone use this for in the home?
So I think in the home, people could use it for many things. I mean, if something breaks and you need a spare part, there are a lot of manufacturers now that are putting 3D files online. There are also databases of 3D files. So people who design things for the home, anything from like a coat rack, like a hook, or there are things that are designed with electronics. People are designing clocks. They're designing all sorts of things, and they're putting it on this website, and people can download them and put them on their cars. So, and people can also share their own. So if you design something that you think, you know, you want to contribute to the world, you can do that as well. So it's not just for kids; it's for all ages.
And how about, does China have an advantage here, or does the United States?
I mean, this is a Dutch printer.
Dutch.
Yeah, this is a Dutch printer called Ultimaker. There are many, many U.S. printers as well. MakerBot is probably the most well-known. They're out of Brooklyn, but they were acquired by Stratasys, which is a publicly held company. So they're quite large now. But they're definitely Chinese manufacturers who are coming out with printers that are quite good, and also even filament, the plastic that you use, which are those reels over there. And I think as there's more competition, it's going to be the prices are going to come down. Yeah, so libraries everywhere are becoming makerspaces because they're seeing the value of having a machine like this, and having their patrons come in, and if they want to design something, or if they just even want to print something, if they haven't designed something, they want to take someone else's file off a website, they can do that. And it's not just here, it's really, I've seen it all over the country. There are libraries that are applying for grants to get these printers, and it's and there are also maker spaces, which are kind of separate from libraries, but libraries can be maker spaces. These places that don't just have a printer, they have many different types of machines. So they can have a CNC machine, they can have all sorts of drills, and they can have laser cutters and printers, what have you. And people pay a fee, and they go in and kind of like a shop. People go in, pay a fee, make whatever they're going to make, have a community of people who are making, which is helpful. Because when I made this app, I actually had a whole community who you know, was helpful to me. I'm a member of a makerspace.
This is ZSpace, and what it allows you to do is it allows you to manipulate an image that's on the screen, and you can do it in three dimensions, or you can do it in two dimensions. Right now I have it in a two-dimensional image, where I can take this, I can see the blood flow through the heart, and if I do this, you're not going to be able to see it on the on the camera, but it's now in a three-dimensional image. If this was on a screen, you'd probably be able to see it also in three dimensions. There's a couple of different things that you can do with this. One is you can use this as part of the dissection, or you can see where things are flowing, or you can do controlled experiments, either with physics or with mathematics, in other areas of the program. But it's really a self-contained unit, and if you have other 3D printing software like Morphe or Maker's Empire or AutoCAD, you'd also be able to manipulate your image, and you can see it and work with it as a collaborative group and edit your image and see what you'd like to do before you I can move this around a little bit so that
you just have to go to a software that's like
put it into 2D mode.
So what are you doing now?
And now you can see this in a two-dimensional aspect. Yeah, it's unfortunate you can't see.
Yeah, no, I do. I just want to know. So that's what you're doing. You're making this robot.
Hi, I'm working with electronics and very simple materials to teach students how to do circuitry. So in the younger grades, the curriculum focuses on simple circuits. So when we work with younger students, we actually present to them a little puppet, a stick puppet, like so, and they work with the colors of the rainbow, and they talk about character traits, and they think about a character trait that they would like to have in their life that would brighten up other people's lives. So my character trait is usually courage. So we talk about courage and having courage and an activity that goes with that. And we introduce the fact that we're going to have courage in our life. When we act courageous, our character puppet lights up. So we're going to get this to light up. It's pretty simple. I work with them and we make a hole, and then what we do is we design the back of the puppet and we put the materials that I give them. I give them something that's conductive. It's called conductive tape. I give them a cell battery and an LED light, and I ask them to create a circuit to try to get the light to light up. So first I give them just the light and the battery, and they play with it, and they put it together, and they try to get the light to light up, because they know that the cell I get from them is energy, and they know that the light will light up somehow if it has a battery. And if they get it to light up with just those two materials, then I ask them to introduce the conductive tape. So I kind of guide them through the steps after they try it themselves, because part of learning is a testing period. It's called failure. So anytime the student fails at something, they're actually learning something. So as you can see on the table, they have a chance to play with all of my simple circuit projects, and they talk about the circuit and the pattern that they see, and we talk about the conductive thread, and they see positive symbols plus signs. So I kind of let them explore for a while. It takes about 15 minutes before we actually start to build. Then when they get the concept down that they need the cell, the power, and the light, and usually what happens is someone figures out that they can take the light and the battery and make it light up. And we talk about why it lights up this way and not this way. So they learn about the positive and the negative on both the LED light and the battery. And then we add the conductive tape to it. So they get a simple circuit, and they just take their imagination and they put the light actually through one of the holes that we make in their puppet, and then they lay the conductive tape down and they try to get their light to light up. So it's an actual project, and it's a workshop that gets them thinking about design, which is part of the STEAMed model. We have science, technology, engineering, art, and math. So you can also make wearable art using the same concept. So this is a mask, and you can have a show with different colored lights, and you can talk about character traits, and if you're all yellow, you all exude this character trait. I'm sure the students could write a play about that. And we also bring the older students into an electronic piece here with this makey-makey. They work with USB cords, and they work with a breadboard, very simple breadboard that they connect to alligator clips, and they can actually start to create and design their own controllers for games. They can play anything that's conductive. They can work with conductive materials. They learn all types of programming. This is going to be basic programming all the way up to high-level programming. In high school, we do text-based programming, and we also do block-based programming. So we can fill the gamut from the early years all the way up to high school.
Hi, my name is Elpidio de la Cruz. I work for New Institute of Technology. I'm the robotics trainer for technology-based learning systems. What I have here are two robots. Okay, his name is Nao, N-A-O, and he's a robot from the French company called Aldebaran Robotics. He could mimic humans. He can sing, he can dance, he can recite a poem, and he can walk. He can grab anything and put it anywhere you want it. It runs on motors, and it runs through a software called Choreograph.
I'm in my department, so Chris is going to hire me to supervise the activity. Chris is going to hire me. So I hired him to supervise the
activity. That's the Tai Chi, a Chinese morning exercise. And I will show you some moves.
That's what I used to see you playing in the
right now. I'm very familiar with this area right now. It wasn't a hard sell, but it was here.
So what we have here is Darwin Mini. It is a humanoid robot using 16 actuators. It runs on an Android tablet using Darwin Mini app, and he can do awesome things. He can greet you. He can walk in advance. He can dance. He can be healthy too by doing some exercise. He loves to boast by doing the handstand.
Get my switch going. There I am. My switch must be.
With the Darwin Mini, you can also play games like soccer. On the defense side, he could lock the ball on his left, lock the ball on his right, left and right, and cover all the areas. On the offensive side, you can walk, do the turn. What he is trying to do now is to kick. Okay. All right. Here you go. And it can also be in fighting mode. You can attack you on the left. You can attack on the right. You can attack in the front. Good? Cool.
So we have to Thank you. So this is our part and get the, you don't forget about Esther's trustees?
Never.
Oh.
I can't right now, but thank you. And I just want to show you the pretzels that we gave you that are decorated. These pretzels are my favorite.
Pretzels are my favorite.
I like it. Composed a small limerick to honor what I think is one of Amy's large contributions to the concept of a 21st century library. Librarian Amy once said, "Innovation must never be dead. Oh, what shall I do? I could open a zoo or let pets in the library instead." So, let's have three cheers for Amy. Hip hip.
Hooray!
Hip hip.
Hooray!
Hip hip.
Hooray!
Leaving here is kind of as exciting as it was when I became director, and I said that I felt like a prom queen, and I still kind of feel that way, which is ridiculous because I was so not a prom queen in high school. And I just want to say that the library is bigger than one person, right? It's all the staff and the friends and the board and the community that supports it, and you're going to be in really good hands with Jessica as interim, and I feel like the next person is just waiting to come here and take you along in the next process. So it's been a really great ride, and I love you all, and thank you.
People that are around you will be blessed. That's all I can say.